And now I'm going to introduce Ryan Rosegger, who is here with us. Rainer is based in Graz, and he's a sociologist who works with his company Scan on issues and processes of urban and regional development, as well as social transformation processes through art. He is also the co-founder of Rostfest, a post-industrial festival in Austria.
So thank you very much. Good afternoon from my side. Thank you very much for invitation to this very interesting conference and this interesting days. So no, first one is missing, okay. So I want to refer now on Felix Stalder, also on different aspects we discussed yesterday and today. And for me, a very important question is when talking about communities, talking about networks, how to bring different communities and different networks together. So I think you know this discussion about the phenomenon that we are living in such echo chambers. We were all discussing in our same peer groups, but not coming together. So, and this is putting divide forward in our society. So I think for the future, it's very important to bring different communities, different networks together. And I think culture and art can have a very, very important role to do so, to do connecting, and maybe to foster the transformation that is needed in the future. So I present now a case of a village and not of a city. I'm working in this village since 2003. It's located in the middle of the Alps in Austria, as you can see in this image. And they found iron ore 1,300 years ago and mined it since then. And this is a specific story about rise and decline of this industry, or maybe let's say about this, of the social impact of this mining industry in this village. So the so-called Iron Mountain, Erzberg, you see the shape in the back, was during the 20th century the symbol of Austrian industrialization. So it was the base for all this heavy industry. The iron ore was coming from there. Nowadays, so 50 years later, it's more the symbol of a decline. It's more the symbol of a system error. We have to deal with it. So in this chart, you can see the production of iron ore and the labor. People have been working on this Erzberg starting from 1940. During World War II, around 7,000, most of them forced labor, who had to dig the iron ore for the weapon industry of the Nazi regime. So this was one special time there. Then after World War II, in the 1960s, around 4,000 people had been working there, mining ore. And since the 1960s, so the labor force had been declining there. So nowadays, around 140 people are working on the Erzberg, but most of them not really in the immediate production, most of them in administration and working as engineers, etc. If you look at the red bars, so you can see that the production is more or less nearly the same all over these years. So labor had been dramatically going back, and productivity had been raising. So this is the effect of technologization with heavy machines. They put it there for production. So of course, it's very correlated to population development with the labor that had been on the Erzberg. So during the 1960s, we had about 14,000 people living in this village. Nowadays, there are less than 4,000 people living in Eisenerz. So we are nowadays more or less on the same level we had in the pre-industrial era in the 19th century. So it was a boom during the industrialization, but now these people don't have been needed. So the factum now is it's the city or the village with the highest loss of population and the highest average age of population in Austria. In 2003, I started with other people initiatives to look at the specific situation, to think about how to deal with different challenges we have there. So, for instance, one challenge was or is that in 2003 or 2004, one third of all flats had been vacant, had been empty. So they hadn't been needed anymore. So we had also streets there in settlements where just a few people had been living without really neighbors, just quite or more or less living alone. So we also faced a, let's say, perforated social life in this village and quite dissolving public infrastructure that has coming along with this situation. In 2006, we made a cooperation with the initiative Shrinking Cities of the German Cultural Foundation. So there was a big discussion going on in Germany about shrinking regions and shrinking cities, especially because of the situation in East Germany. And so we brought parts of the exhibition to Eisenerz also to try to start a discussion about the phenomenon of shrinking regions we have in general in Austria. So with this discussion, we also tried to create measures how to break through these downward spirals you have in such systems, in such situations. So then we introduced the program Redesign Eisenerz with measures in different areas, for instance, economies, how to bring companies there, social issues, education, etc. Really broad program to deal with this situation and also to think about what does it mean to make a development program under shrinking conditions. So the challenge was in this issue that most of the political agenda has the assumption of growth. So what to do in such a situation with the absence of growth. So there had been these different measures in different areas, but I would say also with these old paradigms in the mind, like Felix mentioned before, for instance, of course you can set the landscape, you see it here, as the new resource, and you can discuss about to attract tourism and to develop tourism, but the big question is how to make from former miners now touristic service providers. They are cooking breakfast, eggs, etc. So there are, I think, new models are needed. So we also discussed new resources and said, yeah, a really growing resource in your village are vacancies. Space is a growing resource. So try to deal with this resource of space. And we wrote the concept for arts and culture in the year 2008 and started different initiatives. So the initiative I want to talk now about is the so-called Rostfest. It means rusty festival, but has a second meaning in German. It's a festival we started in 2012 as somehow try to use the space and the potentials we have there. So we invited people from our networks, said, come there. Let's work together, let's perform together, let's celebrate and let's see what could happen with this. So putting also the city into new light was very important for us, so to give the people their new perspectives, how they also can see the city. For instance, this is the same building, you can see it like this, or you can see it like this. So it was somehow an enlightenment, or you can see it like this, or you can do this, like into it, and really putting the whole city into this new lights. So people of the village had been quite impressed what's possible. Of course, a very important target group are the young people. So we made workshops with the young people about the situation they are facing. We're also doing conferences there, about the issue of shrinking regions, about the issue of transformation, about how to find this new mode, this dealing with these challenges, but also conferences in different environments, bringing new content, bringing new paradigms into using the empty rooms. And so you can see before and after perspectives, so really to bring life into these empty rooms, but also try to start a discussion about what is the potential for the future in this village, what you can really do. So now I want to talk about two effects I was observing, what we had with bringing this art and culture impulses and doing together art and culture formats with the inhabitants there. So what effects can it have? So in the first year, in 2012, we asked the mayor and the municipality if we can do an announcement for the festival with the measures of street art a few weeks in advance. And they said, no street art. Because if you're doing this, all the young people are coming and spraying, making graffiti all over our city, and we don't want this. So we said, hey, you don't have that much young people. This is your problem. We negotiated about the issue. Then we agreed each other that we're doing it temporarily. So we got this empty shop window, putting this wood panel on it, doing the street work there, and then we agreed to put it away afterwards. So the artists had been very wise, because as template for the work, they used a perspective of the village out of the 19th century and made it with measures of street art. And 3 weeks after the first festival, we went to the municipality and said, thank you very much for the possibility to doing this. And so now we will take it back. And they said, no, please don't do it, because this is a very nice impulse we have in our village. So this is a picture from now, 2017, it's still there. So for me, this is a very nice learning and effect about the potential of deconstructing stereotypes. So street art is not only just bad or what, it could be also very interesting also for this community. Another effect or learning lesson I want to talk about is about participation. So it was also in 2012, we had an artist tour or explorer there. So they wanted to build a do-it-yourself hydroelectric power plant with materials they recycled and found somewhere. So to discuss that there are other resources than iron ore you can use. So they came there with these materials to architects. So, and the aim was to produce electricity for one mini concert out of this power plant. So they worked for days in this cold mountain river. Both, I would say, a quite slender figure. So very strong in the will, but not in the strength really to work with these heavy materials. And nearby, three carpenters had been living at this time, sitting there the first afternoon, watching to the artists, having a beer. After a few hours, they went to them and asked, yeah, do you need help to put this heavy blanket on? Okay, yeah, please. Help us. After this, every afternoon, after they finished their own building site, they came back and helped them. So this for me is a very good example about participation, because normally, and I'm also working in regional development processes, we are doing participation processes with flip charts and green and red dots you stick on and doing a vision paper, and the vision paper goes to the stakeholders and there it's resting good. So for me, this is a very good example what we can do with performative participation, not just this coercive participation where you just reach a small amount of people. And so you can reach people with, in general, all the resources they can bring in. So just one last sentence. In general, to come back to the networks, so to bringing together different communities and networks, it's very important what Granovetter in the network theory said about the weak ties and the strengths of the weak ties. So weak ties can combine these different communities, and they are very important if you want to work on transformation, if you want to, in general, think about innovation. So these fluid, flexible networks are very interesting when they bring together the knowledge. So thank you very much.
Great.